So good evening. So I've been a physicist studying or working for about a decade now. And there's one thing that has actually been bugging me for all of this time. How do I respond to people who go, "Oh, physics, you must be very smart." Now, I do actually have just about enough social IQ to know that the correct answer is not yes. That's never the correct answer unless you're like a TV fictional detective savant, which would be a massive career change for me right now. But I think people, when they hear physics or when they see PhD after your name, they kind of assume you have this like huge overinflated ego. And for me, doing a PhD was one of the most ego deflating experiences of my entire life. When I was in secondary school, in first year, I got a Valentine's card. Anonymously, secret admirer. And a few years later, a friend of mine, he confessed that he was the one who sent it. And he had had a crush on me when we started school. Until, and this is how he phrased it, he got to know me better. Getting a PhD was more ego-crushing than that moment. I think one of the problems is you get the PhD, but it's very hard to feel special because at that stage, almost everyone you know either has a PhD or will do in the next couple of years. My two best friends, they have PhDs. They are cryptography and atmospheric physics, so we are a very diverse group. But I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, "Suzanne, get out of the university. Get a hobby." So I joined a knitting group. I thought that would be safe. PhD. PhD student. PhD student. Oh, you don't have a PhD. That's great. No, but my dad does. I can't even go home for Christmas because there's a family around the corner. You know, we grew up together. We went to the same schools. And they have two PhDs. One of the few people in my life right now who doesn't have a PhD is actually my husband. This Saturday is our wedding anniversary. We have been married a full year, and he has not applied to do a PhD. I think he's a keeper. But one of the other things is that, by definition, when you do a PhD, you become an expert in something. But that something is a very, very increasingly tiny something. So I have a PhD in physics, so I am an expert in physics. But I'm really an expert in theoretical quantum physics. But I'm really an expert in the theoretical quantum physics of cold atoms that are weakly interacting and form a type of matter called a Bose-Einstein condensate, but only when it's forming vortices, but only when it's in an oval bucket and not a round bucket. And there's probably a very good chance that I know more about this particular subject than the rest of you put together. But this guy probably knows more about the Higgs boson than I do. So I did my PhD in Ireland, and then I moved to Scotland, and I radically changed fields. So I went from the theoretical physics of cold atoms in Bose-Einstein condensates with vortices to the theoretical physics of cold atoms in Bose-Einstein condensates with an extra atom in there. Massive learning curve. I'll give you an analogy because analogies really work very well in quantum physics. Basically, in my PhD, I was sloshing atoms around in a bucket, an oval bucket, and now I'm more of a quantum zookeeper. So my job kind of goes like this. I'm a postdoc apprentice zookeeper, and I'm cataloguing the animals. And I get to the zebra paddock, and I have my form. Shape. Horse-ish. Legs. Four. Seems consistent. Colour. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with zebras, they have black and white stripes. But my form doesn't have options for patterns or stripes or spots or anything like that. I can undo colours. So I think a good compromise would be to take black and white. But my form was written by an idiot who expressly states that I can only take one option for colour. So I tick black, or I can tick white. So I tick black, and I send it off to my boss, the head zookeeper. Who reads the form? It's a zebra. A zebra is horse-shaped, four legs, black. A zebra is a black horse. Now, the upshot of this is that my boss now cannot pick a zebra up out of the lineup. But the zebra's fine. Zebra's fine, okay? So instead, consider this is a quantum zoo now, right? It's a quantum zebra, but I'm doing the same thing. So shape, horse-ish, legs, four. Color. I can only tick one box. Now, this is a quantum zebra. And when I tick that box, I'm making a measurement. I'm making an observation of the zebra's color. And if there's one thing we know about quantum things, is that when you measure them, you change them. So the moment I tick that box that says black, the zebra is now black. I have just broken a zebra. Now this can be really useful. Basically all quantum technologies are based around the idea of breaking zebras in controlled fashion. But the problem is, in the next field you have a camel. And the camel is eating grass or minding its own business, and it turns around. And it accidentally looks at the zebra. And the camel looks at the zebra and notices that it has colour. And now my camel has broken my zebra. So my zoo has not even opened yet, and I already down one exotic animal, because nobody is going to pay to see a black horse. So something needs to be done. So one option is to basically isolate the zebra, make sure no one is looking at it, even accidentally. So I could send my zebra into space. And this can be a really good solution, but it's not always practical to send a zebra into space. Another option is you can protect it with other quantum animals. So you want to surround your zebra with other quantum animals, but not the same animals, so not more zebras, but maybe something which has some similar qualities, like is also black and white striped. So you put your zebra in your field and you surround it with, say, white tigers. And this is the safest place for your zebra to be. According to my maths. Now, hindsight is 2020. I maybe should have tried this with the ring-tailed lemurs first. I'm not allowed back in the zoo anymore. But at least the restraining order calls me doctor. Thanks very much.